to defend her featherweight titles against Brenda Carabajal. You got those four great fighters on the bill as well. You've got a 140-pound prospect, blazing superstar named Brandon Lee on the card as well. You've got Ashton H2O Silk, the latest addition to the MVP roster on the card, fighting at MSG. Something for everyone, August 6th. The official sportsbook partner of the event is FanDuel. Everyone is here. Showtime pay-per-view, MVP. I am hyped. He is hyped. He is hyped. Before we get to the fighters, before we get to your questions, everyone watching all over the world, this great event at this great venue, home, by the way, of the 2023 NBA champion New York Knicks. I don't know if you guys heard the news, but that is happening. I want to welcome the executive vice president of MSG Marquee Events and Operations, Mr. Joel Fisher, to the podium. Mr. Fisher.
Thanks, Ariel. And I like what you say about the Knicks. We here at the Garden are incredibly honored. We're the Mecca of boxing, and we are incredibly honored to host this fight between Jake Paul and HASIM RAHMAN Jr. As you know, we worked closely with Jake and his entire team recently. Jake was an incredibly great partner. He's really into the business of boxing, was a real supporter of women's boxing. But we also know that Jake is also really into boxing himself, and he's really passionate about it. And I'm sure he's in tremendous shape. We want to welcome HASIM here. I'd like to personally thank you for stepping up quickly and stepping down, and what I mean by that, in weight. So we appreciate everything you're doing for that. And as Ariel mentioned, your father, you're following in your father's footsteps, who fought here and won in 2004. The promotion we had a number of months ago with Katie and Amanda was tremendous. It was historic. It was one of the greatest nights of boxing that we've ever had here at the Garden. It was a pleasure to work both with Katie and Amanda. Amanda is one of the best people, boxers, just people that I've ever worked with, honestly, and she's just been tremendous. We know that she'll be ready. Brenda's not here, but we'll look forward to welcoming her for her first fight here. Before I leave, I really want to thank MVP Promotions, specifically Nikisa and his whole team. He's been just an incredible partner. Like Jake, you guys have been great to work with. It's been an interesting road to get here, as we all know, but it's been great, and we just can't wait for August 6th. I want to thank Steven Espinoza and Showtime for stepping up. They've been great partners throughout the years, and we're thrilled to be working with them again. And I'd be remiss if I didn't mention my team, Sal Federico, Joanne Esposito, and Larry Torres, for working on this event. So this will be a tremendous night, a great event, a great fight, and I would say don't miss it. Be here on August 6th. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Fisher. And if I can add to that, right now, MSG.com tickets are on sale. I hear they are moving quite fast, Mr. Paul, Mr. Rahman, so that is good news. Tickets on sale right now, MSG.com. That's where you can get the tickets for this great event on August 6th. Now, next up to the podium, I'd like to welcome Mr. Steven Espinoza, the president of Showtime Sports.
Thanks, Ariel. The first half of 2022 has been a banner 6 months for Showtime, filled with knockouts, upsets, unforgettable moments, legacy-making fights. We crowned an undisputed super welterweight champion. We had Errol Spence Jr. moving one step closer to being undisputed himself. Had a variety of ultra-competitive fights, high-stakes action, and star-making performances week after week. And the best is yet to come in the second half of the year. Stay tuned. But as we turn the page to August 6th, we're offering a different kind of event, but maybe not all that different. Herbert Maori Slade. Herbert Slade. Anybody recognize that name? How about Jem Mace? Anyone? Herbert Slade and Jem Mace were the two boxers who participated in the very first professional boxing match here at Madison Square Garden. February 2nd, 1883. That's right, 1883. First professional boxing match here at the Garden. That's almost 140 years ago. If you're curious, the result was a 3-round no decision, so it's sort of anticlimactic. It would be a huge understatement to say that there's a lot of history here at the Garden. Since that very first professional boxing event, there have been 1,748 more events. That means a total of nearly 1,750 events. But in all those shows, more than 1,700 boxing events, there's never been an event quite like this one. And that's because there's never been a professional boxer like Jake Paul. There's never been a boxer who could headline a pay-per-view in Madison Square Garden after just 5 fights. Vasily Lomachenko did something similar. He headlined the Garden in his 6th pro fight at 5-1. But Jake's doing it one fight sooner, headlining a pay-per-view event, and doing it without the benefit of 400 amateur fights and 2 gold medals. What Jake is doing is remarkable. But more importantly, you can no longer call it a hobby or a fad or a stunt. This is a full-time profession for Jake, a full-time commitment. Boxing is now his calling card, his number one pursuit. He's 5-0 with 4 knockouts. He's facing a fighter in HASIM RAHMAN Jr., who's 12-1 with 6 KOs. RAHMAN Jr., as Ariel mentioned, had about 100 amateur fights. He's been trained by many of the greats. He's worked with Emmanuel Stewart, Calvin Ford, and now Yoel Judah, who steered his son Zab to incredible heights in the sport. Most fighters with 5 fights don't face boxers with that level of experience. But Jake isn't your typical boxer. You know, the fact that he's headlining a pay-per-view, his 3rd pay-per-view with Showtime pay-per-view, is a testament to his popularity and drawing power. Now, Jake could have taken an easier touch, but that's not Jake. After Tommy Fury pulled out of the fight, Jake and his team went looking for an even bigger challenge, and they found it. They found a tougher challenge that probably he should be taking. An opponent who's bigger than Jake, more experienced as an amateur, more experienced as a pro. A real challenge. Why is that? Why take a fight that almost everyone around you is telling you not to? Well, there's one reason. Jake Paul's on a mission to prove himself as a credible professional boxer. And what he's doing is unprecedented. But in a different way, it's really not unprecedented. Strip away the celebrity status, Jake's success as a content creator, and what he is doing, what he's striving for, is no different than any other professional boxer. It's no different than what HASIM RAHMAN Jr. is striving for credibility, for respect, striving to improve skills, doing all the hard work behind the scenes to put it all on the line in one night in front of a massive crowd here at the Garden. Jake's coming off one of the most spectacular knockouts in recent memory, December over Tyron Woodley. The clip of that knockout is one of the most viewed, if not the most viewed, in the history of Showtime sports. Jake clearly moves the needle like no one else. And we at Showtime are proud to be in business with him, and he is clearly bringing the sport to a new audience. The same can be said of Amanda Serrano, who inspires multitudes of young girls every time she fights. Amanda's fight in the Garden with Katie Taylor was the first women's fight in history to headline at MSG, and it delivered with a huge crowd and a fantastic fight. We're also honored to have Serrano back on Showtime. We're proud of our history in women's boxing and proud to have Amanda back for the 5th time. The Showtime telecast starts at 9 p.m. Eastern, 6 p.m. Pacific. It also includes separate bouts with 2 of the sport's most exciting and promising young boxers, Brandon Lee, 25-0, 22 knockouts, Ashton Silve, 7-0 with 7 knockouts. All of us at Showtime Sports are thrilled to be back here at the Garden for the first time in nearly 10 years. It's been way overdue. We thank Joel Fisher and all the Madison Square Garden staff for having the vision to take this event sign on to us in what will be a very exciting evening. Before we get to live action, of course, there will be All Access, bringing you inside the ropes, behind the scenes. That'll premiere July 30th, and we'll see you on August 6th. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Espinoza. All right, let's talk to some of the particulars up here. You know these people, need no introduction. That's Amanda Serrano, Jake Paul, Haseem Rahman Jr., and Haseem Rahman Sr. Amanda, if I could just start with you. I remember before the April fight, it was a whole big deal. She's fighting at MSG, moving from Hulu to the big arena. Now this is old hat for you. Now you're like Mrs. MSG. Now it's kind of gotten like, you know, just another day at the park for you, right? Fighting at the big
now
arena.
It's going to be hard to get me out of it. No, I am truly, truly honored to have such a fast turnaround. You know, the fight with Katie Taylor was a huge event, not just for females, but in boxing in general. And I'm super happy to be back at MSG with my manager, Jake Paul, alongside me. Now, we get to show the world that we're fighters, and he takes off his promoter turtleneck and puts on his boxing boots to show that, you know, he's a fighter as well.
And just curious, you're now going back down to featherweight. Why was this? I keep hearing this was a really important fight for you, that you really wanted to go back down for this next fight. Why so important for you to defend these titles?
Well, these are my babies. I worked super hard for these belts, you know. I went up to 135 my last two fights. The organizations gave me the opportunity to have non-title fights. To get this fight with Katie Taylor, I'm not a legitimate 135 pounder, I'm a featherweight. And I beaten a pound for pound girl for my belt, for two of my belts. So these I work hard for, and I'm a legitimate featherweight, and that's why I need to defend these titles. And then after that, it's, you know, on to the next one, to the other champions.
I want to ask Haseem Sr. a question or two, if I can. As Mr. Fisher said, around 20 or so years ago, you fought in this venue once. Now to see your son, top of the bill, world's most famous arena, fighting someone like Jake Paul, what do you make of all of this?
I'm excited like everybody else. I don't just know how I'm going to feel when Jake's 100 billion fans hate my son. After the fight, you don't hate him.
How do you feel about the fact that it seems as though Jake has chosen your son as his next opponent? That perhaps, as I saw in an interview with your son in Fight Hype recently, that he feels as though Jake is looking past him or thinks that he's the easy matchup for him?
Obviously, disrespectful because Jake is a real fighter. He's a real fighter, and we respect that. But I just think that he's moving too quick. I think he picked the wrong guy at the wrong time. So
moving too quick for your slow ass son who's not gonna be able to hit me. Yeah, you're right. I am moving too quick, fast as shit.
Today, he'll Ric Flair with the WWE stuff again. But I mean, when we get in the ring, then we get in the ring.
So. You're not in the ring, sir. Your son's in the ring. He can't fight for you.
But I am talking. Him. Excuse me for talking while you're interrupting. Why are you being rude at the press conference?
You're saying we in the ring.
Why are you?
We're not getting in there with you. You're not in the ring. It's me versus your son. And that's what he doesn't understand either. He thinks he's you. He thinks he's you. And that's his biggest mistake. He's not you. And August 6th, people are going to see that. I'm ending that whole ass legacy that y'all whole ass family got. It's over with. August 6th.
Well, if you want to really talk about legacy and family, then after he beat you, I got a little brother that's a cruiserweight that you can rematch my son where he can beat you for the second time. And I got a little brother, Muslim Kaysen, undefeated, can beat your brother.
I already beat his ass in sparring too, and he knows that too. We got the footage.
So you can just beat all of my family.
They be with this footage stuff, man. They be putting out what they want to put up. Did you put out the footage when you turned around and ran away from me in the ring? Why you ain't put that up? You turned your back and ran like a I ain't gonna cuss, but you turned your back and ran. So why you ain't put that out? You put out what you want to put out, content creator. We gonna see you on August 6th, man.
If I can ask you, Haseem Jr., yesterday, Jake said on my show that there was some doubt as to whether or not you would show up. Can you clear that whole story up? Were you threatening not to show up? Were you asking for more?
Bismillah. First and foremost, I want to thank Allah for this opportunity and just to be here on this platform, just to be at this stage. This is such a huge opportunity. I never once, ever once even second guessed or even doubted the outcome of this fight. I did no negotiation through the internet, and I'm not going to. But whatever they sent me and they said, look, this is take it or leave it. Either you take it or you leave it or there ain't no fight. And I took it. And that's that. We here right now. So all this BS about going back and forth about everybody, well, we know that because we've been in this game a long time. But all that stuff back and forth about the money or whatever. I'm gonna be the lowest paid opponent, but I'm the biggest. I'm the biggest. I'm the one that's giving you any credibility. None of your other opponents gave you any credibility. So why shouldn't I get more than them? But like I said, I'm not here to negotiate through the media. I'm not here to do none of that. I'm here to end this facade that he's calling a career. So we're gonna see. We will, and we're gonna see on August 6th. When Jake Paul fall, we definitely gonna see that.
Jake, I've heard them say now a couple times, sparring isn't fighting. That sparring match that you guys had about 2 years ago isn't exactly what's to come, and that you're perhaps putting a little too much stock into that. What's your response?
Well, I don't know why they're so worried. The fact that they keep on saying that's the telltale sign. Sparring isn't fighting, because, I mean, you're probably a little bit nervous about what happened. But obviously...
What happened? Nothing. Under the lights. You be bringing up the sparring. You the one posted the sparring. You don't like getting interrupted, do you?
Under the lights, 10-ounce gloves, of course, is different. That's why I do this sport. I don't do this sport to spar. I do this shit to fight. And when he gets under the lights, Madison Square Garden.
And you ain't fought nobody.
In front of 20,000 people.
You ain't fought nobody. Nobody. Everybody you fought have been their debut.
Who have you fought?
Everybody you fought been their debut.
Who have you fought? Tyron Woodley, UFC champion.
I just fought somebody 20 and
0. Ben Askren.
What are you talking about?
Nate Robinson.
Champions in MMA. NBA, champions in MMA. NBA, NBA champion. No boxers.
And that's why you're next
on
the list. You're next on the list. You're next on the list.
I know.
You're next on the list.
I know.
That's why I'm fighting you. No shit.
Your first love.
No shit.
Don't turn your back and run like you did when we sparred. Don't do that. And I will be using both hands.
You'll see.
And I will be using both hands.
You'll see. I got something for you.
I only use one hand when I spar him.
Oh, man.
I only use one hand. He can't even spar nobody with one hand.
I would just love to put out this
footage. He can't even spar nobody with one hand. He's not even at that level. I box this man with one hand behind my back. And I promise you, he turned his back. He turned his back and ran from me. That's what's going on in his whole camp. That's all they do. Look, Rock. Don't do this. Don't switch southpaw. Don't sit here and say you don't. Because when I spar you, you do the same thing. It's always a handicap. And that's what I was trying to tell him. It's a handicap in here. Don't get too, you know what I'm saying, too confident. I'm trying to help you. I'm trying to help you. I've been trying to help him since I came here. But he thinks he's... I don't know what he think is going on, but he definitely barking up the wrong tree. I'm going to fuck you up.
All right, this is Tremendous Theater. I want to give you guys a chance to ask some questions as well. So let's open it up and let's keep this rolling here. As you can see, no love lost between HASIM RAHMAN Jr. and Jake Paul. My friend, you're up first.
Yeah, hi, this is Maestro. I'm very pleased that we see a former heavyweight champion of the world right here in HASIM RAHMAN. Champ, what? Yeah, round of applause. Champ, what is it about your son that you think gives Jake Paul the confidence that he seems to have to take on your son on August 6th?
Flat out, I'm gonna give you the honest answer. I don't know if my son gonna like it, but I'm just gonna tell the truth because that's what I do. My son has really underperformed and underprepared for pretty much all of his fights. So, but he will be ready for this one.
What?
Do you agree with that, HASIM Jr.?
I think that the potential that's inside me has not been reached yet. So, yeah, I agree. I think that I could definitely have performed better in all my fights. So, on August 6th, we're going to come fully prepared.
Dad, why'd you say that at the press conference, Dad?
What are you talking about? He just told you to tell the truth. This ain't nothing he ain't said to me before. What are you talking about?
It's bring your kid to work day.
Yeah, all right. Bring your gloves and your boots on August 6th, because I might knock you out of both of them.
Up next.
Jake, good afternoon. In your previous fights, you've shown the world that you take boxing very seriously. It's your full-time job right now. But this is the first time you're fighting a professional boxer who also takes it seriously. Does your training camp, does your preparation differ at all now?
No, nothing changes. We know he's going to come out southpaw, so I mean, fighting southpaw for the first time. But other than that, nothing really changes. You know, I fight professional boxers in the gym, spar them all the time, 2-3 times a week for the past 3 years. Guys way better than him. Steve Cunningham, 3-time world champion. Guys like that caliber. So nothing really changes. We're prepared for this. And
So when we spar, why I couldn't turn southpaw when we spar? Why your corner and your trainers and you were so adamant about
you were south. You turned southpaw in that
did
too.
Not.
We had the footage.
I did not. Go show it. Show me some. Show me turning southpaw. Show me turning southpaw, please.
We have the footage, but I'm gonna let the fans see the footage of you turning around on August 6th.
Show the footage of you turning around as soon as you get the back pedal.
You got your ass beat, you know it.
How? You in here jumping on top of turnbuckles. There's no winner or losing in spawn. There's no winner or losing in spawn. So what are you talking about? I was there to work with you, to actually help you get confidence to go against a guy that was 5-5 with no fights. So what are you talking about? And I still was handicapped, boxing you with one hand. Go watch the tape.
Why were you so mad after? When I backed you in the corner, why are you so mad? Why are you turning around and running? Who runs in a boxing ring?
You act like we was in a track. He's a runner, he's a track star. What's going on? Why are you running in a boxing ring? Do you know how to box? Have you learned that yet? You learned that you can't run yet? Have you learned that much yet? That you can't be running in the ring? You learned that yet?
Keith.
It's only been 18 months.
Keith Eidick, BoxingScene.com. My question's for HASIM Jr. HASIM, how much do you expect it to be a challenge to fight at the lowest weight of your career? And how much weight will you have to lose in training camp before the fight to get down to 200 pounds?
We already close, man. We already close. I'm not worried about the weight. I was just in camp for a fight, and then I came and I got right back in the gym. I came to New York. I was already in the gym when they called for the fight, so I'm not worried about the weight. The weight not a factor. I fought at 200 pounds for years in the amateurs. I haven't fought there as a pro yet, but I'm looking forward to bringing back them amateur days and bringing back even some things that I was doing in the amateurs that I haven't done in the pros yet. So losing some weight, it's almost like I'm fighting an amateur. So losing the weight is exciting for me, and it's gonna open up doors for me to even do even more in the boxing ring.
Just curious, I don't know if you caught that. You said like fighting an amateur. Do you take exception with that comment?
No, he's gonna get beat up by a singer, a musician, a seashell collector, an amateur.
Disney boy. I'm a Disney boy. You is not about to beat me up. Who have you ever beat up?
I'm all of these
Who
things.
Have you ever beat up? You ain't beat up nobody.
You sound stupid.
Who have you beat up?
5-0.
You ain't beat up nobody. You ain't beat up nobody. Anybody can get the 5-0 fighting nobody. Come on, man. You ain't fought nobody that boxed before. You fought everybody in their debut and then rematch somebody. Stop it, bruh.
Perfect. So that's why we're running it. That's why you're the next opponent. No shit. You're a speed bump.
I know.
Another name on the list.
I know.
A pawn.
Yeah, okay. You say that now. I'm about to give you your first loss. Stupid.
Karen
Bautz here with Ask the Experts. Question for HASIM RAHMAN Jr. HASIM, in your last fight, right over here, you were unsuccessful. It was stopped. Did you feel like it was a premature stoppage in the last fight? And how important is it to now have a great performance after your first career loss?
Credit to Kenzie Morrison. He won the fight. The referee stopped it fair. But every article that covered the fight afterwards stated about it being stopped earlier, being premature. The commentators were saying that it was stopped earlier, premature. We've seen wars in the ring where that went well beyond what happened in that fight. And when I go back and watch the fight, you can see in the fourth round, I took a punch similar to the punch I took in the fifth round and then proceeded to win the rest of the round. So who knows what would have happened if they would have let the fight keep going. But that's behind me now. That fight doesn't matter going into this fight. I learned from that. So now I got to teach this little kid a lesson.
And a question for Jake. You were originally supposed to fight Tommy Fury. We know what happened there. I know it was important for you to fight a real boxer, but now you're fighting an opponent who's bigger than Tommy Fury, who has more professional experience. Is this a tougher fight than Tommy Fury?
Yeah, 100%. This is what I do. You know, I take hard challenges and challenge myself more and more with each fight, increase the level of opposition, and give the fans what they want. People say fight a real boxer. Here we go. This guy's bigger than me. He has more experience. There's no reason that I should win this, but I'm proving to the world and proving to the kids out there that if you set your mind to something and you truly believe in yourself and you're dedicated and you're mentally low-key, have to be insane.
And you stack the deck. Don't forget you stack the deck.
You will win.
Don't forget you got to stack deck.
And that's what I'm proving
to people. Bring me down
to
cruiserweight and then put a rehydration clause in the contract. Don't forget about none of that.
You already making excuses.
Don't forget none of that. It's take it or leave it.
Why you already making excuses?
Don't forget that's take it or leave it. That was take it or
leave it. Why you already making excuses for yourself?
I'm not making no excuses. I'm telling the truth.
Sounds like you're making
excuses. Because you're leaving it out. Because you're leaving it out. Let the people know.
Excuses as to why you lost.
Let the people know.
Excuses as to
you always talk about, oh, he's bigger than me. Oh, he's bigger than me. Oh, he's a heavyweight and all this and all that. That's cut because we come in the cruiserweight.
You took all that off the tape.
Thank you.
With the rehydration club.
Thank you. So don't yeah. No, that's not, you cannot do that.
That's out.
So will you not, you'll be 215 on the night of the fight.
You don't know how much.
And I'll be 195.
You don't know how much I'm away on the night of the fight.
Why does that matter? 15 pounds ain't nothing.
Then why are there weight classes in boxing? Dumb fuck. Shut up, whoever the fuck you are. Dumb shit. Shut up.
But you keep calling me a heavyweight.
Sit the fuck down.
But you keep calling me a heavyweight.
Recording me like a fan.
Why you recording me like a fan? Why you keep calling me a heavyweight? Talking about how I'm a heavyweight if you're not fighting me a heavyweight. If you was really that, you would have fought me a heavyweight.
What weight class?
You would have fought me a heavyweight.
You sound so stupid.
If you was really that, you would have fought me a heavyweight. It wouldn't have been no, oh, let's bring him down. You seen I just weighed 224 in April. It wouldn't have been no, oh, bring him down to 200 and make sure he can't go up over 210. Come on, man. Stop playing with me. You put a 10-pound rehydration clause in the contract? Stop playing. Bruh, shut your ass up. Shut up.
Let me just chime in just one quick second. Just wanted to ask Amanda.
He ain't fought nobody.
Wanted to ask Amanda a quick question because when the fight was announced, Jake had mentioned that his business partner, Nikisa, said, are you sure you want to do this 12-1? I'm curious what your thought was when you found out that Jake was accepting a fight against HASIM Rahman Jr.
Well, at first I was like, I mean, this is tough. Boxing isn't a game that you play. But then I thought and I said, Jake Paul is doing it for a reason. Jake Paul, he's, you know, we're so much alike in the game of boxing, opposite outside of it. But I know he has all the heart, courage to go out there. He's gotten better. I've seen him in the gym, seen him training. He's training like if he's fighting for a world title. So I have all the faith in his work ethics and he has that. He has that hammer, so every hammer can neutralize any opponent.
Schmo.
All right, question for Jake. In the first Tyron Woodley fight, we had a bet with the tattoo, I love for the winner. And then if Tommy Fury would have showed up, you would have had a bet, $1 million with Tyson Fury. Both you two are confident. Can we get a bet on the line for this upcoming fight?
Jake don't honor his bets. I'm not betting this, man. I don't even gamble, but he don't honor his bets. I'm Muslim.
I haven't lost them. No shit.
What are you talking about?
I keep on winning.
You just bet on a man and lost $1 million. What are you talking about?
The bet didn't go through. Eddie Hearn pulled out.
Oh, Eddie pulled out?
You want to bet $500K? You posted on your Instagram.
I did not say I wanted to bet.
You did. You posted
on your
Instagram.
You can't read.
You want to bet $500K and you posted a picture of your bank account.
I never said I wanted to bet. You can't read.
You posted a picture of your promoter's bank account.
Did I read? Did I say I wanted to bet? I never said I wanted to bet. Don't put words in my mouth.
It's on your Instagram.
See, this is Jake Paul right here.
You're stupid as fuck.
This is Jake Paul right here. He want to twist things up. Go to my Instagram.
You don't want
to
make a bet?
And go
Let's
look.
Make a bet. Let's make it right now.
Bet what? I don't bet. I'm not about to bet no money.
Broke
I don't
ass.
Bet money.
You
All right, let's bet this.
I don't bet money.
When I beat you,
I don't bet
when
money.
When I beat you, you have to change your Instagram name to I Let My Dad Down.
I'm not.
We already have the handle.
I'm not entertaining you.
We already have the handle.
Focus on August 6th. This ain't about no bet. This ain't about no bet. This about you.
Instagram handle.
And what you gonna change yours to? And what you gonna change yours to?
You pick. I don't give a fuck.
Yeah, right. I don't got time to be playing with you, bro. We not playing on.
You got all the time in the world. What were you doing before this, bro? You're a broke bitch doing nothing.
I was training. Bro, shit, what are you talking about, bro?
The last fight you ever take.
You scam people, bro. What are you talking about? If I was scamming people, I wouldn't be broke.
You sound so stupid.
If I was scamming people, I wouldn't be broke.
Begging me for more money.
What are you talking about? I didn't ask you for nothing.
Begging me for more money.
I didn't ask you for nothing. I didn't ask you for more money. I never asked for more money. So what are you talking about? I never asked for more money. I took the lowest amount at the highest level. I'm the highest level opponent you face, but I'm getting the lowest amount out of anybody else.
No one knows who the fuck you are. Two days ago, you had 5,000 Instagram followers.
Why you bought my followers? Why you bought me followers then?
You have 5,000 Instagram followers 2 days ago.
Why you bought me followers
than you, bro?
Boxing don't have nothing to do with followers.
You're not worth shit.
Boxing don't have nothing to do with followers.
That make you a better fighter because you got more followers?
Boxing don't have nothing to do with followers.
All right.
This will be the last time anyone ever hears you. It has to do with how much you get paid. That's why I'm the highest paid boxer.
You crazy. Rockman's going to be in boxing forever.
The fuck?
You wild. If you
read their Instagram, I can make that bet happen. If you read the Instagram.
All right.
Let's make the bet happen.
Is it?
You want to bet 500?
Is it going to happen? This is the last chance. Because
y'all don't
seem
confident.
Jake, you about to get knocked out, bro.
Okay, then bet on it.
All right.
I told you, I don't bet money.
Then bet on it.
I don't bet money.
I said let's bet Instagram names. I'll change my name to whatever you want if you beat me. But you have to change yours to I Let My Dad Down.
You listening to me?
He don't want to make the bet.
Jake.
He's all tough. Jake. Look at them big old arms.
He's so big and strong.
He's going to knock me out. I haven't fought nobody, but he won't make the fucking bet.
I don't bet money.
Pussy motherfuckers right here.
I don't bet money. I don't bet money, sir.
August 6th. If you weren't excited for this card going into this
press conference. That's an Instagram name switch.
You
won't bet, but you're so confident.
I'm not entertaining you and your content, bro. I'm here to whoop your ass. I'm going to fuck you up on August 6th. And that's the bottom line. Point blank, period.
All right, we'll leave it at that. Showtime pay-per-view, co-produced by Showtime pay-per-view and, of course, MVP. August 6th, world's most famous arena, the mecca of boxing. Jake Paul versus HASIM RAHMAN Jr. If you weren't excited, like I said, I mean, you got to be excited now. And, of course, the return of Amanda, the real deal, Serrano. Multiple prospects on the card. Again, something for everyone. And if you're in the area, MSG.com, tickets on sale right this second. So go snatch them up. It's going to be quite the scene. It's going to be theater at its finest right here at the world's most famous arena. We're going to square these gentlemen off. And, of course, Amanda's going to get her time in the sun as well. Thank you all for joining us. Thank you for watching. August 6th, we'll see you at the Mecca.
La ilaha illallah, Muhammad Rasulullah.
Thank you, fellas. Just stand back here for a minute.
You get the picture.
Black, my guy, what's going on?
Thank you. Thank you. All right, let's just have Amanda.